So here we are. We're about to, we're in the home straight for 1404 LTS. Now, LTSs go back to 2006. Our very first LTS was 606. The 06 was my fault because I tried to wedge, I thought we should wedge a bunch more things in to make it, to make it even better. But what we've learned is that, that predictable cadence of releases is really, really powerful. So we're gearing up now for 1404 LTS. This is our 6, 8, 10, 12, 5th LTS release. And if you look at statistics about what people are actually using in terms of enterprise Linux, very heavily that is shifting towards Ubuntu and shifting towards the LTS releases. If we look on the clouds, it's really astonishing to see the number of cloud servers out there that are on an LTS release versus the latest release. Now, of course, the fact that we do maintenance and support for the interim releases is really important because it lets people use the latest tools, it lets people use a server platform that is aligned with their desktops. But the LTSs really are special. The largest desktop deployments in the world for Linux are on our LTS releases and the largest server deployments as well. So I think this cycle has been a fantastic example of how knowing that we're doing an LTS and focusing on the LTSness, right, the things that really make a difference for people who are going to be using this platform for years, make such a difference. You can see that in the number of people who are running Trusty today as a desktop Trusty today on the server. It really has shone, and I'd like to credit the team that's been focused on QA for raising the state of the art for free software platform QA. The automated testing, the automated rollback, the commitment that they make to knowing exactly where we stand on any given day and fixing the issues that have arisen on that day has made a huge difference. So let's dive in. We are delivering the best of free software, the best of all of free software. You know, it's in the nature of the Ubuntu project that we want to be a place where people feel they can express what is valuable to them in free software. And I think in this last two-year period, we've seen a reaffirming of that, for example, with the GNOME Unity project. So this is the Ubuntu GNOME project. This is a team that stepped up to say that GNOME is really important to them, and they have the ability to do what they need to do inside the Ubuntu community to harness, to get the value of everything that is being put by everybody else into Ubuntu and deliver a great GNOME experience on top of that. The same is true of the KDE community. I think it's really important that Kubuntu has continued to thrive and to strive to get even better. And the other desktop environments, including, of course, Unity. So we are shipping the best of free software, and we have now just a few weeks left to make sure that it really is the best of all of free software. So the first thing is to make sure that we have brought into the platform in some way everything that you guys think is important for this LTS for the next period. From our perspective, from my perspective, I think we have we've created a mission of convergence layered on top of all the goodness of Ubuntu. You know, we haven't stopped doing anything that we were doing in Ubuntu in support of all of the other good ways that people use free software. But we have created in the last 2 years something pretty special on top of that, which is this unique effort to create a convergence platform, a platform that spans every kind of personal computing. The way I see it today, there are really three areas that are interesting from a computing perspective. One is personal computing, and it's no longer just your PC, right? It's your phone. Perhaps your most personal computer today is your phone, your tablet, your PC, your laptop, and your television. Our vision is that you should be able to co-opt any screen that you run into and use it as your personal screen. And I think we've made some tremendous progress in that regard as part of the run-up to 1404. We will see our first tablet releases based on 1404. So we did our first phone release based on 1310, our first tablet release based on 1404. This convergence mission continues. There are a bunch of healthy benefits that have come to the desktop from this work on convergence. Our battery life is better, and we really care about battery life. So anything we can do in the next 6 weeks to improve battery life for mobile devices of any form is really valuable, really important. This work isn't just for Unity and the convergence story, of course. Everybody who's using an Ubuntu-based laptop, doesn't matter what the platform is, doesn't matter what the GUI looks like, is benefiting from this focus on mobility, on personal computing. The other area that's super important, of course, is the cloud, and then now Internet of Things is a really interesting area as well, getting Ubuntu onto all sorts of embedded devices. In this release, we are landing a whole bunch of new capabilities around scopes. And scopes are the easiest way for you to integrate content and capabilities from the internet, from the world that the new world of computing, which is always connected and always accessible, to integrate those directly into your desktop. Now, today we have two implementations of all of this. We have the desktop implementation, and then we have the mobile, the touch implementation. But those are completely converging. And the one thing we're really passionate about is the idea that scopes, you can write a scope just once, and then that scope should be useful on all of these platforms. So if you're looking for a lightweight way to get involved or to bring something colorful, interesting to the desktop or to the mobile world, scopes are really the single cleanest, easiest place to start. There's a whole bunch of different tools for creating scopes. There's a really interesting long list of scopes that have been created and that are evolving really quickly. And we're just starting to scratch the surface, I think, of what people are going to do with scopes. What's really interesting for me about scopes is that we're really pioneering the next wave of the system interface, right? Scopes are not an application; they really are the system homepage. So we're completely transforming the way people feel about the home screen of their phone, right? Instead of hunting and pecking and finding an application, you've got everything that you want right there in the home screen, and you can get to it really quickly. Lots of interesting work being done both on the front end, in the dash itself, if you're interested in that, climb in, it's all beautiful QML. And on the back end, of course, there are tons of different ways to create scopes. You can do them in a bunch of different languages, and we're adding ways to do that. So it's very interesting for us to work with people who want to add the ability to create scopes in Node.js or other new languages, which are suited to this kind of lightweight integration. Convergence in scopes is now real, now that we have tablets as a first-class citizen. So for people who have scopes, it's now really interesting to take them and extend them, make sure that they work really well across both the phone form factor, the tablet form factor, and of course also the desktop. And that convergence story, I think, is the most interesting thing happening in native app development today, right? How can we make it really easy for people to create applications which feel great in one hand, feel great in two hands, feel great with a keyboard and a mouse? I want to thank the application team for the work that they've done in this cycle for celebrating what convergence is possible. And we're not alone in doing this. If you look at Windows 8, for example, there's a lot of work happening on the proprietary side of the software world to make convergence possible. But I think what we've got is pretty special. These apps feel to me better than what I see happening on the Windows front. And I think that's something we should be really proud of, right? When there's an important fundamental change in the way people think about software or think about applications, to be able to put free software right in front of that is a special opportunity and one that I relish. And it's great to see what a vibrant ecosystem we have around app developers. The design team and the community working on different core applications have been super productive in this past 6 months. And so we've seen a real evolution in terms of the scale and quantity and quality of the applications that are getting pushed up into the App Store. And more interestingly, I think we're starting to see second and third generation designs. We're starting to learn what works best, and starting to make sure that we push the leading edge of possibilities. I don't know how to do this. If I can stop the screen share and come back. There we go. This phone is feeling fantastic. So those of you who are tracking the phone development, I'm running a Nexus 4. I don't know what you guys are running on. But just in the last in the last week, we revved to the new version of the kernel and the core hardware support libraries that come with the device, and it is feeling super sharp, super slick, super tight. I'm just loving it. We had great fun at Mobile World Congress in Barcelona demoing the phone interface there, and we sort of cheated a little bit because we pre-landed into that image a bunch of code that isn't yet ready to ship. It's all open source. It's all there. You can get it, but we've got a very high standard for quality assurance for this device because there are people using them as the real phone, and so we didn't want to land all of that code in this image for MWC. So I know what's coming, and I can't wait for it. But even just the stuff that's on here right now is feeling really, really good. I had a fun experience when I was in South Africa recently. I wanted to get a local SIM, so I went down to the phone store and we were going through all the paperwork. You have to give them your ID, and then you get a pay-as-you-go SIM, and this, that, and the other thing. And when you're sort of registering it, you have to get a text message from them and everything. So he asked for the phone, and without thinking, I gave it to him. The guy popped out the old SIM, put the new SIM in, in came the text message. He clicked on it, wrote down everything he needed to do, deleted the text message, and gave me the phone back. And only halfway through, I suddenly realized, hold on, this guy's never actually seen. I bet he's never seen Ubuntu before, right? And he was just using it. He unlocked it. He got the text message. He did the whole thing. So, yeah, we know that there are lots of glitches and shortcomings and warts and bugs and, you know, things that can be improved, but it's super motivating to see Ubuntu in the wild on this really, really interesting, important new form factor. I'm loving the HTML5. I'm loving the web apps. I get my BBC news from here. I now feel pretty comfortable using Google+ on this phone as well. It's not my only mobile device, but I'm increasingly starting to find all the apps that I can use here rather than on something on my golden cage, my gilded cage elsewhere. So well done to all the many teams and people who are making that rock, making that possible. In particular, the HTML5 stuff is looking really sweet. So the new browser stuff seems to be coming along really nice. Performance has improved dramatically. I think that the work that's happening on mobile feeds directly into our browser performance for the desktop, so enhancements there are really valuable. I was delighted to see the alignment shaping up around the new Chrome backend and Mir, which is going to make all of this super smooth and be super smooth on the desktop as well. The browser, of course, is the center of, you know, it's the most important application, and we have the best browser in the world, both of them. We have them right here as first-class citizens. So, you know, I think we have the apps that really matter. Let's climb back into this. And so creating apps is a lot of fun. The HTML5 story, I think, is matured nicely. I think it's really important and lucky that Google announced that HTML5 apps on Android are going to be WebKit and Apache Cordova. And, of course, we've picked WebKit and Apache Cordova. So we should feel really good about alignment between what we're doing and what the rest of the world is using. The vast majority of smartphones that are out there today are well aligned with what we're doing on HTML5. But native apps are just a lot slicker, quicker, and nicer. And so it's really exciting to see the native application ecosystem growing as well. QML is shaped up really nicely. I'm excited that we've got Qt 5.2 landing. Also excited to be getting Qt 5.3 in due course. The Digia team are doing really great stuff with Qt and with QML. I feel good supporting them and encourage you guys to support them. It's an amazing toolkit, amazing team behind it, very open, very easy to work with, and cross-platform. So it's really starting to be possible to write native applications for Ubuntu and Android and other environments as well. Something that I'm really interested in is the use of Go as an emerging programming language. I think it is capturing the essence of the future of what the hardware platform looks like, which is massively concurrent, lots of things going on at the same time, and making it possible to write native applications very elegantly that take advantage of that concurrency. So I think it's the most exciting language out there. At Canonical, we use it very heavily, and I'm starting to spot that, you know, the cool kids out there appear to be using it heavily too and loving it. I'm very excited that Canonical is leading the way in integrating Go and QML. So what does that mean? It means that you can start to write native applications for Ubuntu Touch that will run on other platforms as well. So we think you'll be able to write native applications with Go and QML. The front end is as easy as the web, right? It's like using web technologies, except it's compiled natively, so it's super fast. And you've got this fantastic new language, Go, at the heart of it. So those of you who have itches to scratch, you want to learn a new language, or you want to kind of be bone up on the stuff that seems to be really moving at pace, go check out Go, and go check out the Go QML integration. There'll be an app contest for the Go community in the next couple of weeks. I think that's underway, and that'll be a fun way to kind of stretch your programming legs in new and really interesting ways. But overall, the app story, the Ubuntu app story, is really interesting. So whatever you like, whether it's HTML5, C++, QML, or Go, give it a go. And thank you very much to everybody who's climbed in and helped make this tooling better in the last 6 months. Now, the LTS stands for long-term support, and we mean it. I've been delighted in the last couple of weeks there have been a series of threads with the tech board and various leads of the different communities, Edubuntu, Zubuntu, Kubuntu, and so on, making clear what they want to do in terms of LTS commitments for those communities under the big Ubuntu umbrella. Big things that are really strong stories now. We have hardware enablement revisions, right? What that means is that every 6 months, we're going to push out a new or support for new hardware into Ubuntu. And it's really important that all of our desktop environments track that and work across that new hardware. So every 6 months, we will introduce optional new kernels and graphics stacks for the latest hardware support for all of our environments. So those of you who are working on different desktops, please make sure that you have a plan to support the latest hardware with your environment. You'll get much more users, your users will be happier. We're doing all of the grunt work essentially in certifying and testing the kernel and graphics stack and X and everything else that goes into that new hardware support. It's a roll-up of all the work that we're doing with Dell and HP and Asus and Lenovo and so on, all of their PCs. It's really valuable work and really important for our users that, you know, if you want them to use a desktop environment, that they're able to use that with their latest hardware. We're making a 5-year maintenance commitment to 14.04 for the desktop, long before the yes, I believe that's the case. And with that comes policies around stable release updates and main inclusion reports. So please dive in to that, dig in, and make the most of it. Right. So that's the personal computing side of Ubuntu, but we're also an anchor for people who are doing really, really interesting stuff on the cloud. And so I think it's really important now, as we have the final run-up to 14.04, that those of you who have a couple of PCs knocking around that support virtualization, go ahead and build OpenStack clouds. Now, Ubuntu is the reference platform for OpenStack development. Most of the people who are contributing to OpenStack are doing it around Ubuntu. We put a huge amount of work into making that as easy as possible, integrating and packaging and delivering all of the latest stuff and doing continuous integration of the latest OpenStack stuff on Ubuntu. We are committing that on this 14.04 LTS, we will deliver Icehouse and Juno and K and L on 14.04, so that people can always use 14.04 with the latest version of OpenStack, which I think is really, really important. But the more people we have kicking the tires, building clouds, giving us feedback, and exercising all of this, the better. There are some very large Ubuntu OpenStack clouds built or being built. It's very exciting behind the scenes. I get a little bit of a peek occasionally into some of them, and it's, it makes me very proud to see the biggest clouds, the biggest companies building great clouds on Ubuntu and on OpenStack. We can only do that because we have such a wide community of people who are exercising the platform on different hardware. And feedback before the release is so much easier to respond to than feedback after the release. So there's this month of window of opportunity left to really polish everything up for this release. Let's make it a cracking good one, as opposed to an easy one to crack. And then looking further afield, the question is, okay, so OpenStack gives us this distributed Linux experience, this distributed Ubuntu experience. What do things look like on top of that? And I think we're onto something really meaningful with Juju. Just in the last couple of months, there have been some really interesting companies stepping up and saying, oh, this is really useful, and they want to contribute to Juju. But what really matters is all the things that people can do. And so the way Juju works is that we have charms, which distill all the operational stuff that you have to do to make Hadoop work or MySQL work or Ceph work or Rabbit work. And those charms, think of them as like packages for the cloud. They handle the installation of software across multiple machines. They handle configuration of that software across multiple machines. They handle connecting up and updating that software across multiple machines. They're a layer above configuration management, so they can include things like Chef or Puppet to help them do configuration management. That's a good way to do it if you know Chef and Puppet. But they're a layer up in terms of abstracting for the user the way they want to think about integrating all of the different pieces in their application or their solution. There have been a bunch of really nice movements forward in Juju just in the last couple of months. The first and my favorite is the creation of bundles. So if you, I think I can demo this, if you go to jujucharms.com, this is my canvas. I can drag and drop different pieces of software on there. So, you know, the classic example is I can take MySQL and put it in, and then I can take WordPress and deploy that just using the defaults, and then I can connect these up. Voila, now I've got a blog, MySQL talking WordPress, and that's all up and running on the cloud, which is really, really nice. But say I wanted to get a whole bunch of things going, then I can get a bundle, which is a pre-configured whole set of things, and I can zoom out a little bit, and all of those things have now been sent to the cloud, spun up, configured in multiple units, integrated, and all of that's happening live, real time, on pretty much any cloud that matters. So this is really interesting because it allows people to collaborate at a much higher level, right? Now suddenly we can collaborate around, instead of collaborating around individual pieces of software, we can collaborate around organizations of software, you know, clusters of software, bringing pieces of software together to do useful things. It's really interesting to watch teams of system administrators having conversations around this, right? Because it allows them to express different ideas about what would work well, what works better, different configurations, permutations, combinations, and so on. So a lot of fun to be had with Juju. Key areas to contribute, because this is an LTS, we've got a bunch of charms that are all around 1204. It's time to start porting those charms forward to 1404 so we can exercise them with Trusty, make sure that they work really well with Trusty. Also, new stuff being charmed up, a bunch of new things just landed, but it's a huge world out there, and there's tons of stuff still to be done. Also, areas that are interesting in Juju itself, we get a lot of requests for support for CentOS, Red Hat, Fedora, and so on. We'd love to take patches for that. So if you span the Ubuntu world and those worlds, then that's an area where you can make a meaningful contribution. But mainly, I think, climbing in on finding a piece of software that you use every day on the cloud or on servers, especially if it's kind of scale-out oriented, and finding the charm for that and enhancing it or testing it or kicking the tires on it in one way or another. Right. I think that's just about a wrap for me. That gives us a good stretch of time for questions and answers.